Hey, thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the CEO Grilling. Today, we have Rahmat Khaimuddin, CEO of Bukalapak. So just quick introduction between myself as well and our relationship with Bukalapak when, well, Digital came to us to say, ask us whether we would like to moderate this session. I said, oh, we would love to because we have a very long-term good relationship with Bukalapak. First, because of the founders, Zaki and Fajin was also our Endeavor entrepreneurs. And secondly, we are also part of the shareholders of Bukalapak through our Endeavor Catalyst. So Rahmat, thank you very much for joining the session. Welcome to our CEO Grilling. We're going to grill you for the next 20 minutes with all of the discussion and questions on leadership. So the topic today is about effective successions on transitional and remote leadership. So I don't want to introduce you because of your bio is can be read in the speakers, but I know that you have a very extensive experience in the corporate world, ranging from the top consultant company, and then you were also leading the cement manufacturing industry, and then banking, and if I'm not mistaken, also you are leading an airline service industry as well. Now, before we go into the Bukalapak, I'd like to understand, because we're topic on the leadership, what's your experience in leading those different companies? I mean, it definitely will be exciting, but you know, different types of background, industry, and different, definitely culture and behavior. So I'd like to know how was your experience on that part first?
Yeah, thank you, Pak Waya. Yeah, basically, just say hi, everyone. Rahmat here. So, as Pak Waya mentioned, over maybe like almost 20 years of my career, I've done a few things. But if, you know, in terms of function, I would say my career has been, you know, three things. One is strategic advisory. Second one is investments. And the third one will be general management in terms of function, yeah. And on in terms of industry, basically the ones that have senior positions will be transportation service. Basically, we run airport service company, ground handling, cargo handling, engineering. But in terms of like as a holding company, and then I used to work in a conglomerate. With 40 companies, eclectic, you know, property, manufacturing, and then I got parachuted into one of the factories, basically, in manufacturing, doing cement business. And then my last gig before Bukalapak, I worked in a commercial bank. I think overall, in the end of the day, like, you know, of course, they're all very different. They all create different products, different services. But once you start moving around, you start thinking about the similarities rather than difference. Yeah.
That's true.
It's all about kind of the business model, whether it works or not. You know, whether you can basically create sustainable profits, if you will. And then it's also about the people. How can you basically, you know, recruit, explain what you're gonna do to the people, and then probably, like, you know, develop them, reward them, and those are the kind of, like, you know, big picture work that I do. So that I use as my guidance when I start moving industries. Yeah. And maybe the one thing that I got after all this time, so I stayed maybe, like, you know, a few years after, and not by choice, but basically because of some calling. You say, okay, move here, move there. But I think in the end of the day, what brings me, what I think also is, like, besides all the similarities, I'm less surprised now to all the changes. So just every time I came, I was like, okay, find a few big picture things, and then you start learning and not panicking.
That's great. I know that you get a lot of these kind of question a lot, Rahmat, especially when you're starting to lead in Bukalapak in January 2020. But we know that Bukalapak, if I look at the previous companies that you were leading before and now Bukalapak, maybe the biggest difference is the age of the team that you are leading right now. Because in Bukalapak, maybe now you are the big brother instead of the youngest in the previous company. So how do you see that kind of different types of team at the current moment? And then how do you adapt to that kind of change in leading the company, especially in Bukalapak?
Yeah, I mean, I think basically since I begin my career, I always start as this kind of like, you know, the young maverick, if you will, right? Because you're a consultant, like, you know, in your early 20s, you start advising very senior people. So that is a role that I've been very comfortable, if you will, to do. And until maybe my last gig. And yeah, as you said, I used to be the youngest board member as a commissioner in my bank, and then the youngest director in that bank as well. And basically, in that kind of organization, what they look for you will be it's kind of like technical expertise, fresh ideas, and of course, you need to make sure that you are culturally fit. Yeah, of course, you have to respect. Like we are Asian, we are Indonesian. You have to put yourself into it's kind of the peers, but without being look at someone like how do you call it that upstart or jump up guy. You have to be polite and everything. Well, in Bukalapak, when I join, I check. Turns out maybe I'm one of the top 1 or 2% oldest, and of course. That is something new for me, but that is okay. In the end of the day, I have to realize that I'm actually not that young anymore. I just need to flip my thinking. It's like, okay, what would these guys like? What would be like? You know, the young version of me will need from the leader, and of course this. My team, they're all, you know, very energetic, very technically proficient, and what we need to make sure is that all the knowledge or the quote unquote wisdom, if you will, help them do their job better, and also kind of protect them for the mistakes that maybe we have made before. So that is kind of role that I'm trying to play here, because in the end of the day, like in many organizations, your employee is probably technically more proficient than you are, and then you should let them express themselves, work as well as we could. But of course, we need to provide them with that circle of safety, and as a CEO, that will be my job.
Great, thank you. When talking about these young generations, and especially they haven't, I think, faced any crisis before, not like our older generation who have been experiencing that, I think, three or twice at least within our generation. Now this young generation is facing their first, let's say, crisis within this pandemic, let's say in the beginning of 2020. And it's also at the time when you are also starting leading the Bukalapak. So I can imagine coming into a new company and then facing the crisis, and then also the team is also facing that first crisis. What was your action in order to get all of these get into place and make sure that Bukalapak is going on the right way when you face this kind of crisis?
Yeah, basically, unfortunately, I don't know, unfortunately or fortunately, I have my own fair share of being near to the epicenter of crisis over my life. Yeah, so I graduated from high school in 97.
Yes.
Just like after I graduated, Indonesian or Asian financial crisis happened. So yeah. I went to school in the US doing electrical engineering at MIT. Graduated in 2001. So just when I graduated, tech bubble just burst. So
that's correct.
I saw a lot of my, I was lucky to get a job in the US at the time. And I saw a lot of my friends get their offer rescinded and all that kind of stuff. And then another thing is, basically after I graduated from my MBA, I got my MBA in 2008. Then, you know, global financial crisis happened. Well, at the time I decided to go back to Indonesia, and I looked like a genius, but I was in school in the US learning about finance, learning about debt market in 2007. Right after all these things, mortgage-backed securities unfolded. So I got the kind of like side view of what's going on. And one thing that I've learned of all this experience is that crisis will end. Crisis happens and it will end. Typically, some of those crises happen because there is some kind of fundamental economic law that is being broken. and after that, it will kind of normalize, right? So, you know, in Indonesia, this kind of COVID crisis, it become hot in the beginning of March, mid-March, yeah, if you will. And when I decided to ask people to move to work from home, of course, there is a lot of fear in the organization. First thing, you know, I did a virtual town hall, and I tell the story. It's like, okay, what you need to know is, I mean, of course, fear is a very natural reaction, but the first thing is make sure that we are still alive. You know, we are still healthy. As long as we still have our health and soul, then we can always survive. You know, the rest can is less important. So first is about safety, and the second thing is that, you know, this crisis is not going to be the end of the world. Hopefully, it's just things that is going to happen from time to time, part of life, and it will, you know, these two shall pass. Right, in Indonesian we call it badai pasti berlalu.
That's
and,
true.
And you know. You know, there's always like also a saying in Al Quran is like after with hardship come peace, right? So
that's true. That's correct.
It's always like, you know, you just need to be optimistic. So like let's focus on the things that we can control, and kind of learn to accept what we cannot, right? You know, the fact that COVID happens, you cannot control that. It's fact of life. Mm-hmm. But we can change how we work. We can change how we operate. You know, we can take care of ourselves, and that is what we're gonna do in that crisis. And one thing though that I keep reminding them is our team is during COVID or this type of pandemic, service like Bukalapak, the e-commerce, is needed more than ever. So it's kind of we feel like we have our own crusade, if you will, or obligation. To operate, you know, we cannot just shut down and say like, okay, all you go home and rest and come back when everything is you know, nice and dandy. You know, we just you have to take care of ourselves, but we also have to we have to play a role in this situation because we are needed. So that is what we try to do in Bukalapak.
Yeah. Okay. That's nice. I mean, I can imagine the transition of entering a new position and then leading a new team and then facing with this type of crisis, especially in the startup world where competition and is very tough. Since you mentioned about doing it remote, I mean, I know your data is you have 6 million online merchants, and then you have 6 million offline merchants, and then about approximately more than 100 million customers. How did you manage that with leading it remotely and having the team remotely and keeping this business afloat for the last 8 months?
Yeah. For the most part, it's relatively, we are quite lucky that we are technology company, right? So, so a lot of this can be done at home, if you will, right? We just need to put a lot of some infrastructure, kind of like how to check in, how to communicate. There are, like everything else, there are some kind of skeleton work that we need to do, and that one we try to put all the health protocol to ensure that everyone can do that safely. Of course, this also impact our customers. So we continue doing some education. You know, in the beginning, it's just about hey, warung owners, you know, be careful doing this. You know, wash your hand. Find ways to not to touch the money physically, or if you did it, don't shake hand. That kind of things that we do, but we translate it into multiple local languages because you know that not everyone can speak Indonesian. You know, so it's like in Japanese, in Sundanese, and whatnot. And then we also know that a lot of people come online, and not all of them are savvy online users. And these are the kind of things that become, you know, nice target for the bad intention people, you know, the bad act users, because there are quite a bit of new users coming online. Definitely. In the past 8 months. Mm.
Definitely. I think your business is growing always in this e-commerce side, right? Well, that's nice to see that positive side through the pandemic. I know the time is about 2.5 more minutes, Rahmat, but I'd like to ask one more question. Like, how do you see this in the coming years? How do you foresee this? I mean, would this be becoming a new normal or a new standard within Bukalapak business process itself? Or will you be seeing new innovation and adaptation in the coming uncertainty of the next 2 years? We don't know whether this pandemic will finish very soon, or it will last until the next 2 years, or so on. How do you see that within your leadership?
I think the fact that we have proven that we can work, let's say, from home for the past 8 months, kind of will create some sort of like demand for the flexibility of workplace. Yeah, so I think that is something that we'll probably continue. We need to ensure also that people can still make personal connection. Mm-hmm. So we need to figure out once all this thing quiet down, maybe flexibility, but from time to time, we just have to meet to build the bonds. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's quite interesting to see that there are some things that maybe we can make more efficient with this type of environment. Also, we see a lot of new demand. So we improved our ability to scale up very quickly. Maybe not right now painfully, but next time less painfully. So, but overall, I think this pandemic will kind of teach us on what is really important for us to survive as a society, as a community, right? We are in Jakarta. It's quite nice to see if the traffic is still quite good and the sky is blue. So if we can play our role to keep that way, maybe good. I think this pandemic will teach us to be leaner, to be more efficient, to be, you know, to kind of focus on other things. And then once all this over, hopefully those efficiency and focus will strengthen us to grow again moving forward.
Great. Thank you very much, Rahmat. I'm so sorry that we have to end this session because of our time. Again, I wish you all the best with Bukalapak and the ventures in the coming 2 years, and furthermore, definitely, but facing the pandemic. Just a quick closing, leadership is about leading successfully into the next level. So I wish you all that as well, that you, as a CEO of Bukalapak, wishing you bringing Bukalapak successfully into the next level as well. Thank you very much, everybody. Appreciate everything watching our session. Goodbye.